morning. I'd like to welcome you to CityLight Church's online service. And I want to wish you a happy Resurrection Sunday. This is different than any of us have ever celebrated Easter before. We've never done it like this before, but you know what? How many of you would agree with me that coronavirus cannot stop us from celebrating the resurrection of our King? And we just want to thank Jesus this morning and worship him for the price that he paid on the cross and what he endured unto victory. And you know, in his resurrection, we celebrate the victory over sin and death. And that resurrection life has emerged. And the Bible says that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is the Spirit that lives and dwells within us. And so this morning, because the Spirit of God is inside of us, we have authority to decree his life into the earth. And right before we go into worship, I want to invite you, would you begin to decree and declare with me resurrection life? Because our world needs an encounter with the resurrection power of the Spirit of God in this day. And I believe that this is the church's finest hour to begin to open our mouths and decree in partnership with the Spirit of Christ that resurrection life is flowing in our world. Would you do that with me now? Father God, we thank you that you sent your Son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins when we were still sinners. He died for us. You demonstrated your love and you paid this perfect price, Jesus. You paid it all so that we could be with you and that we could see your kingdom established in the earth. And not only did you die and give your life, but the thing that's so remarkable is that death couldn't hold you down. But you came and you emerged from that grave with resurrection life. And this morning we recognize that that resurrection life is still in the earth. It's in believers who carry the power of your Holy Spirit. So together, as we gather to worship this morning, we decree resurrection life in our world, in our nation, in our homes. Over our region, we declare the resurrection life of Jesus. We proclaim life, and we say that our world is blessed with life and not death. We give praise to you, Jesus, because the victory was already accomplished. You secured the victory over coronavirus. You secured the victory for our health and our wholeness. And we stand together unified. Every place that we're watching, God, we come together in unity with the message that your victory has secured the breakthrough already for the crisis that our world is in. We declare resurrection life this Resurrection Sunday for our world to encounter the power of the living God. God, we love you. And we honor you this morning. We honor you. There is none like you. In all the earth, there is none like you. And you are worthy of our praise this morning. And we give you our praise and our adoration. We love you with all that's within us. We worship your name this morning. Would you worship the Lord with us today? Wherever you are, let's lift him up.
Yeah. Thank you. conquer the grave. Amazing grace. Well, hey, CityLight family and friends and all our viewers out there, we're so thankful that you got to join us and get to join us for the Easter message that we're broadcasting. And I'm praying that this message reaches worldwide. My pastor, Pastor Josh Grimes, will be preaching from Dayton at a church that was able to film him giving a sermon. But before we go to that, I'd like to invite you, for those that call CityLight family your home and those that want to give to the Lord, we invite you to give right now. And if you've ever been to a live CityLight service where we gather, we do these things called declarations during our times of offering. And I just want to pray a declaration right now as people are preparing to give their gift. And that declaration is an Easter declaration. So we're just going to pray that the work of Jesus on the cross, we're coming in agreement with that by being obedient to Jesus, that the work of the cross breaks any curse. So we're going to pray right now. Thank you, God, that this is an Easter Sunday message, that we don't just celebrate your death on the cross, but there's something bigger than your death on the cross. Your death on the cross was payment for our sins, but your resurrection, God, was evidence, God, that we have been given eternal life, God. And so as we become obedient to Jesus, we enter into your promise of eternal life. God, we thank you that we get to give generously to the work that you're doing, God, that this message can be broadcast, Father, far and wide, and the message of your redemptive work can go into every home, God, can go into every smartphone, God, can be broadcast all over YouTube and all over Facebook. And so we give in the advancement of the gospel. We give because of your redemptive work on the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, we have a lot of really cool stuff that has been going on. So as we've talked about every week, we've turned our facility here into a resourcing place where people have been dropping off donated items left and right. It's been amazing. We brought in pallets of food. I'm waiting to hear back for about 40,000 pounds of food. If you're praying for us, keep praying. We're really anticipating that. We had a local business donate 6 gallons of hand sanitizer that we're going to get out to the front lines of people that are serving the hardest hit areas in our community. So we're so thankful for that. If you are just, hey, I would love to volunteer, we're going to put a phone number in the comments below, and you can give a phone call to us and say, hey, I'd love to volunteer, maybe delivering a food basket to one of our elderly population that's been calling. If you know someone that's saying, hey, I know I have a neighbor or a friend that is in desperate need, feel free to have them call that same number, and we'll get some resources out to them. We don't want anyone to go hungry during this time. So we just love you. We're so glad that you joined us during this Easter season, and we're going to play a great sermon from my pastor, Pastor Josh Grimes.
Good morning, City Light Church. I'm so glad that you chose to join me this morning, this Resurrection Sunday, here in your living room. My name is Pastor Joshua Grimes. I'm the Regional Executive Director for Open Bible East, and it's a privilege to be able to minister to you this morning from the Word of the Lord. Let's first start out with a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to celebrate the greatest event that ever happened in human history, the time in which you came and paid a price that we could not afford. Lord, I just ask that you'd be with us today. Though we're separated by distance, we're brought near by technology. I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would speak into our hearts and speak into our lives. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Well, I don't know about you, but this kind of is a different Easter Sunday morning. Matter of fact, it's been over 100 years since Easter services were canceled, and they're canceled all across the world. Now, we might not be meeting in a church building, but yet Easter itself has never been and never will be canceled. We're still celebrating the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. However, we're doing it different than we've ever done it before. But I believe that God is going to speak to your heart and speak into your life today. We live in such a time and such a day that things aren't going the way we had planned. I didn't plan this. I don't know about you, but just a few short months ago, I would have never have thought that a situation that we're facing in this world would be going on. I never would have thought that we would not be able to meet together. I miss the handshakes and the hugs and the high fives. I miss seeing all the beautiful faces of my brothers and sisters in Christ all across Open Bible East. I miss that. But yet we have the availability to have technology. That's great. But we still miss each other. Sometimes things don't go according to plan. This morning, I want to share with you about one of the most tumultuous weeks in the lives of the disciples. Because you know what? The Holy Week, as they call it, Easter Week, as they call it, did not go the way the disciples had planned. They thought it was going to go one way, but yet it went another way. Sometimes life doesn't go according to our plan. But I want you to know this morning that though it's different than we planned, God is still in control. And He's still underneath, behind the scenes, is holding everything together. So let's start talking about the Holy Week. A week ago, we celebrated Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is the Sunday in which Jesus Christ was going to enter into Jerusalem for the very last time. I would like to read out of Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. I want you to listen to this. There's some very important principles I want to draw from it. As Jesus and his disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them out and said, hey, go to the village over there, and as soon as you enter it, you're going to see a young donkey or colt, which no one has ever ridden upon it. I want you to untie it and bring it to me. Now, if anybody asks you, what are you doing? Just tell them. Now, this is an interesting phrase. Tell them, the Lord needs it. And we'll return it to you soon. So the two disciples left and found the colt standing in the street just outside the front door. As they began to untie it, some bystanders demanded, hey, what are you doing untying that colt? And they said, the Lord has need of it. So they let him take it. Now the Bible says this, then they brought the colt to Jesus, they threw their garments over it, he sat upon it, and many in the crowd spread out their garments upon the road ahead of him, and others spread out leafy branches, and they cut in the fields, and Jesus was in the center of this great procession, and the people all around were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna to the highest, which means praise God, or praise the Lord. Blessing on the coming of the kingdom of our ancestor David. Praise God in the highest. I want you to think about this. The start of Holy Week was Jesus Christ sitting on a young donkey that had never been ridden upon it. Somebody put their own clothes. He sat upon it and comes into Jerusalem in what we call the triumphal entry. Now, interesting enough that the palm branches had a meaning to them. See, here's what they would do. They would cut palm branches and they would wave them and they would hand them to a king who was coming into a place to rule and reign. Many people would take off their coats and they put it and they'd line the streets. So when Jesus was coming in on that Palm Sunday, he was coming in and they were saying, Hosanna, praise the Lord. They were declaring him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Because listen, in the disciples' mind, Jesus was coming in to rule and reign. They thought in their head, this is when Jesus is going to dispel the Roman Empire and he's going to take control. He's going to liberate the nation of Israel and we can once again worship the Lord freely. The second event that happened in the Holy Week was what's called Maundy Thursday in the liturgy calendar. I used to think as a kid it was Monday Thursday, but it's really Maundy, M-A-U-N-D-Y. The word Maundy comes from a Latin word which means a new commandment or a new covenant that I give. You see, Jesus spent 3.5 years teaching and training his disciples for this very week, for this very time, because Jesus knew the plan and the will of God. He for 3.5 years prepared his disciples for it, training them, teaching them, saying, hey, listen, this is gonna have to happen. He sent disciples to get to a place together so they can sit down and have the Passover meal together. Now, in the Jewish community, the Passover meal together was one of the most important things in the whole Jewish calendar. And it represented when the nation of Israel was delivered from the nation of Egypt by the angel passing over the Israelites' homes, but yet caused the death of the firstborn male of all the Egyptians' homes. This was a feast that had been celebrated for thousands of years. It was the most important date on the Jewish calendar. Jesus sat down with his disciples, but it was a little differently than normally it is. See, here's what Jesus did. He sat down and he took the traditional bread and he broke it and he said to his disciples, this is my body, which is gonna be broken for you. And his disciples are trying to figure out what is he talking about? What do you mean by broken? And then he took the cup and he said, this represents a new covenant. See, Jesus was accumulating all of the 3.5 years of teaching his disciples that, hey, we have come to the place where the plan of God is gonna be released. This cup represents the blood of a new covenant that I'm giving with you. And as often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me, remembrance of this point in history where all of it changed, where I came to pay the price. His disciples assuredly asked questions, Jesus, what do you mean by this? And he plainly spoke and he said, I am going to have to die. His disciples begin to break out and like, no, far be it. You're not gonna die. Why? Because on Palm Sunday, they hailed him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In their minds, he was gonna deliver the nation of Israel. They're gonna be free from Roman tyranny. But now he's saying, I'm gonna die. That's not what kings do. Kings don't die. They rule, they reign. This was going against their grain of thought. Interesting enough, something astonishing happened during this conversation that Jesus had with him. We pick it up in Luke chapter 22, verse 21 through 24. But here at this table sitting among you is a friend. And this man is going to betray me, for he has been determined that the Son of Man must die. But what sorrow awaits for the one that betrays me? The disciples begin to ask each other, man, who would do such a thing? Now, interesting enough, look at the next sentence. Then they begin to argue among themselves about who is the greatest in the kingdom. Now listen to me, think about this for a moment. Jesus is now sitting down with his disciples. He had that triumphal entry. They hailed him as King of Kings. He's sitting down with a Passover meal. He is letting them see that I am the fulfillment of this Passover meal. I am the one that pays the price. I have to die. They're arguing about it. No, far be it. No. He says, not only am I going to die, but one of you are going to betray me. Now, interesting enough, think about this. He tells them this, and they're looking around, who would do it? Who would do it? Who? And then all of a sudden, they broke out in an argument. They broke out in an argument asking themselves, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? Now think about that. The church does that a lot. When things get tough and things we don't understand are happening and we can't figure this out, all of a sudden we start arguing over things that really have no meaning. It doesn't really matter. Does it strike you as odd that they begin to argue over who is greatest in the kingdom when Jesus just told them, guys, I'm gonna die. They're gonna crucify me. I'm gonna lose my life. I'm gonna break my body for you. I'm gonna spill my blood for you. I'm gonna pay the penalty of humanity. And now his disciples are sitting around arguing over who's the greatest in the kingdom. Well, thank goodness there was at least one disciple who didn't engage in the argument. We pick up in John chapter 13, where it says that John laid his head on Jesus's breast. He didn't engage in the argument of who was the greatest. He just laid his head on the breast of Jesus. Now, why would you lay your head on somebody's chest? You do so to hear their heartbeat. Here John was in the midst of the argument of all the disciples declaring, I'm the greatest, I'm gonna sit on his right hand, I'm gonna reign with him. John just laid his head to hear the heartbeat of Christ. Oh, what a beautiful picture. This argument broke out in such a way that Jesus declared to them, we pick it up in Mark 14, Jesus said, all of you are going to be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep are going to be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. But listen, here's what Peter said. Peter said, no. If everybody else stumbles, not I. I'm not going to do it. I'm willing to die for you. He made bold claims. Now, how many of you in the midst of turmoil and trouble and hardship and difficulty go to the Lord and you make these bold claims and these bold proclamations saying, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. I'm giving this up and I'm following you here, only to find out that you fail. All of us can identify with Peter. Jesus looked at Peter and said, Peter, not only are you going to deny me once, not only are you going to deny me twice, but before the cock crows, you will have denied me three different times. The next event we pick up on is Jesus, knowing what he would have to suffer, knowing what he would have to go through. He said, guys, I want you to join with me. I need to go pray. I need to spend some time with the Father. They went out on the Mount of Olives and Jesus left his disciples there to pray and he went off to pray. We know the story. You know the story. Jesus is crying out to the Lord, the pain of his heart. Listen, he was all God, but yet he was clothed in flesh. He understood the pain and the agony and the crucifixion and the shame that he would have to bear. He understood that he was going to carry the weight of the world upon his shoulders. He knew that. And that's not what was heavy on his heart. What was heavy on his heart is he also knew that bearing the sins of humanity, that his own father, that he had connections with, his own father, that they were connected together, that that connection would have to be temporarily broken. Why? Because God would have to turn his back on the sin and turn his back on his own son. And that's what was weighing heavy upon Jesus. He went out to find his disciples asleep three different times. How many times is a church sleeping on the job? How many times does God ask the church to rise up to an occasion? And what do? We find ourselves lollygagging and sleeping. That's exactly what his disciples did. And now Jesus comes out three times. Could you not bear with me 1 hour? Could you not? I mean, this is his greatest time of need, but yet his disciples decide to sleep. What happened? Judas Iscariot shows up. Right after Jesus poured out his heart and prayed with such intensity that his forehead began to produce droplets of blood, Judas shows up. Judas wasn't just a disciple. He was a part of the inner circle. How do we know that? He was entrusted to care for the money. You don't let someone care for money that you don't trust. Here this guy was in the inner circle who came to deny and came to reject and came to offer Jesus up to these soldiers of the Jewish temple. Immediately, Peter did what he said he would do. The Bible says in the book of John that he pulled out a sword and he cut off Malchus's ear. Malchus was the assistant to the high priest. He was literally in high priest training. He was literally working towards to be the successor to Caiaphas. And we know that no high priest could ever be a high priest if they had blemishes on their body. This man lost his ear, and it wasn't just painful experience. He was also losing his ministry. He was losing what he worked his whole life for. But yet Jesus rebukes Peter. Man, put away the sword. I mean, think about it. I just told you a few hours ago this was going to happen. Put the sword away. And he took Malchus's ear. Man, it shows the grace of God, doesn't it? He took Malchus's ear and he placed it back and he said, be healed. And the man was whole. I don't know about you, but if I was Malchus, I think I'd have dropped to my feet and just started worshiping him right then and there. They drug him into what we call a kangaroo court. It was illegal. It was absolutely illegal for a Jewish man to be arrested at night and tried at night. Now, we know that when he was drug away, his disciples dispersed, but there was somebody who followed him. We know that Peter did. He followed from a distance. He stood outside. He was trying to listen in on what was going to happen. And you know the story of Peter. 3 times he denied Jesus, but he didn't deny Jesus to a Roman soldier. He didn't deny Jesus to somebody who had authority to do anything. He denied Christ to a servant girl who really, in the scheme of things, didn't really matter in the sense of she could not do anything about it. The 3rd time he denied Christ, he actually used profanity. He cursed the name of God and said, "I've never known him." And immediately the cock crows and he recognizes, man, Jesus said this would happen, and it happened. He began to weep bitterly and ran. Jesus is dragged before a court in the Jewish high priest's home, which was illegal, at night, which was illegal. They got trumped up charges. They paid people bribery money to lie against him. And they found him guilty, but yet they had no authority to carry out any kind of formal punishment. So they turned him over to the Roman government, and they stood up, crucify him, crucify him. I mean, come on, you know the story. I'm reiterating something because I want you to get the understanding that this week was tumultuous. It didn't go the way they had planned. It didn't go the way they thought. But yet it was still the plan of God at work. The disciples didn't understand it. The people didn't understand it. But yet God was still at work behind the scenes. They found Jesus guilty. They drug him in front of Pontius Pilate and Herod. You know the story. They says, man, we find no fault in this man. We think he's innocent. Matter of fact, let me release somebody else. No, we don't want anybody else. We want you to crucify Jesus. What am I supposed to crucify him for? He declares himself as the King of the Jews. On Palm Sunday, didn't he enter in as the King of the Jews? Didn't people wave their palm branches declaring him as the King of the Jews? Didn't they lay their coats down, which was customary for Jewish people to do when a king came in to rule and reign for the first time? That's what we want you to do. Jesus was sent to be scourged with the cat of nine tails. That is that most people don't even survive. That's one of the most tumultuous things you could go through. They would take these, they would strip them nude, and they would begin to throw down the gauntlet of these leather straps, and it would begin to pull away, and literally, it's like tiger claws. It would rip the flesh from the bones. Blood is pouring out. They beat him beyond recognition. They ripped the beard from his face. They put a crown of thorns, making fun of him who said he's the King of the Jews, and they thrust it into his skull. Now, we don't know where the disciples were, but we know that Mary witnessed this. We know that others witnessed this. We know that they were heartbroken. Why? Because just a few short days earlier, he was coming in and it was a party. He's going to rule and reign, but now he's being beat. He's being smacked. He's being punched. A beard ripped from his face. A crown of thorns thrust into his skull. Their king is not ruling, but it looks like their king is failing. Not only that, they tied him to a cross that he could not carry. He had so much loss of blood. He was so unrecognizable, so weak from the tremendous beating that he couldn't carry his cross. And they made a man from a foreign country help him carry his cross. They hung him on the cross. Now, when we look at a crucifix, we see that Jesus is hanging there, and as bad as it looks, every crucifix I've ever seen shows them with loincloths, but that's not what the Roman soldiers did, because the Roman soldiers didn't just want to hurt you. They wanted to torture you, but they also wanted to shame you and your family. Jesus hung on that cross completely naked. They wanted to shame him. Now listen, that was to go fulfill the prophecy that when Jesus Christ bore our sins, he also bore our shame. One of the first things that sins bring into our life is shame, and Jesus took that shame for us. He's hanging on that cross. They gamble for his loincloth. He loses his life. They come along. Now, you might not have heard this before, but I've done a lot of research and study because I never could understand why, in the process of Jesus dying, why did they take a stick with a sponge with what they call bitter or sour wine and put up to his mouth? Why did they do that? Was it just to torture him? Listen, remember, this whole thing was more than torture and pain. It was to shame and humiliate. Josephus, who is a writer in the first century, said that what they would do is when they would produce wine, which was the preferred drink of the day, when they would produce wine, they had different grades of wine, and the cheapest wine, the wine that didn't taste the best, it wasn't preserved as well, and it would go bad fairly quickly, and it became sour wine. You couldn't drink it. It didn't taste good anymore, but yet it still had properties like antiseptic properties. They would still use it to clean wounds and stuff like that because their water had so much bacteria in it. So they would use this sour wine kind of like a medicine or an antiseptic. And Josephus said that one of the things that the Roman soldiers would do is they would have a stick with a sponge, and in their outhouses, in their bathrooms, they would have that ready, and they would take that and dip it into sour wine, and they would clean themselves with it. When Jesus hung on that cross, when he was suffering and dying, one of the last acts of humiliation was to literally take a toilet brush and put it in his mouth. Now think about that for a minute. Jesus did that for you. He did that for me. He didn't just bear your sin. He bore your shame. He took the pain upon himself. Listen, he paid a price you couldn't afford. He did it for you and I. We know what happened. Jesus drew his last breath, and he died on the cross. When he died, great events happened in the world. All of a sudden, earthquakes, complete darkness. All these supernatural phenomena began to take place, and it caused the head Roman soldier at the feet of Jesus' cross. He heard the last words of Jesus. He heard Jesus say, "Father, forgive them." He heard Jesus say, "It is finished." And when he said that, immediately it went dark, and earthquakes and thunder and lightning and all these events. The Roman soldier recognized this was not a mere man. His statement was, "This has to be the Lord. This has to be who he said he was." Hanging above his head was a sign that said, here is Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Now that takes us to Resurrection Sunday, or in the last couple hundred years has been called Easter Sunday. Now, on Easter Sunday, everybody wants to talk about the resurrection, and I do want to talk about the resurrection because it's the greatest event in history. But I want to look beyond just the resurrection. I want you to see what the disciples were feeling. First of all, Mary and the ladies realized that Jesus' body wasn't properly taken care of because they had to get him off that cross before they went into the rest of the feasts of Israel. They had to do it the right way. So they just, you know, kind of got him in there. So they wanted to make sure that after this, the Jewish Feast of Unleavened Bread and Passover was done with, that they're going to go properly take care of him. So on that Easter morning, that resurrection morning, the ladies are carrying the spices, they're carrying the things they need to properly care for the dead, and they're walking in, and they notice that the stone is rolled away. Mary Magdalene freaked out. "Somebody stole his body," she said. She ran back and told his disciples, and we don't know how many, but we know at least two ran as fast as they could. One of them being Peter, one of them being John. Now, interesting enough, at his crucifixion, we don't have mention of any disciple except one. The one who laid his head on Jesus' breast, who didn't engage in the arguments. He also stood by and held Jesus' mother to the point where Jesus looked down and said, "John, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son." Now this same disciple, along with Peter, started running, and it says that John got there first, but Peter went beyond and went in, and they found it was empty. And they seemingly just left. And now Mary Magdalene is weeping and crying. They've stole his body. They stole his body. And all of a sudden, she looks over thinking it was a gardener and realizing this is no ordinary person. And he says, "Who are you looking for?" "I'm looking for Jesus. They took his body." She began to recognize his voice. Man, she wanted to go hug him. She realized, wow, Jesus did raise from the grave. Man, she went back and she told the disciples. Now listen, they didn't see him yet. She goes back and says, "Hey, they didn't steal his body. He rose from the dead." Now listen to me, guys. Now we have the luxury of looking back throughout the course of history. We have the luxury of being what we call Monday morning quarterbacks. We have the luxury of looking back and looking at the whole story as a whole. And we realize and recognize now that Jesus had been preparing his disciples for 3.5 years to accumulate at this particular moment in time. Everything that Jesus said would happen has now happened, but yet the disciples had a different idea. They had a different plan. They thought it was going to go a different way. So when they came back and said, hey, somebody stole his body, they went to run. We got to find it. They get there, they find it's empty, they leave. Mary Magdalene finds out he's rose from the dead. She goes and tells his disciples. Now listen to this. After she tells them, listen to the story. We pick it up in Luke chapter 24. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, which is 7 miles from Jerusalem. I've been on that path in Israel. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that they had happened, and they had talked and discussed these things. Jesus himself suddenly came and began to walk with them. He asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you're walking down this road? They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them said, hey man, are you the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard the news? Who hasn't heard about the things that happened the last few days? Jesus said, well, what things? The things that happened to Jesus, the man, notice, the man from Nazareth. They said, man, he was a prophet who did powerful miracles. He was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death. They crucified him. Now listen to this next statement. We had hoped he was the Messiah who came to rescue Israel. We had hoped he was the Messiah. Now come on, think about it for a moment. Palm Sunday, these same guys are waving palm branches. Palm Sunday, these same followers are laying their cloaks down. They are partying. They are declaring that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's coming to deliver the nation of Israel. He is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is the chosen one. He is the Son of God. On Monday, Thursday, when they sat down to take what we call the Last Supper, Jesus said, hey guys, I want to let you know this is what's going to happen. My body's going to be broken. My blood's going to be spilled. This is all a fulfillment of what I've been preparing for. They refused to believe it and yet argued over who's going to be greatest in this kingdom. When he was dragged through court, when he was beaten, when he was crucified, and now we find that he had rose again. You would think that when Mary Magdalene got back and she said, hey, his body wasn't stolen. I saw the Lord. He was alive and well. He was not dead. I saw, listen, Mary Magdalene wasn't just some stranger. She knew Jesus. She walked with him for 3.5 years, saw him every day, cooked him many meals, and served him well. She knew who he was. She goes back. He's risen. He's risen. He's risen. But guess what? His disciples stay hidden, and some of them even said, man, we have got to get out of here. And they're fleeing, and they're leaving, and they're running. How often do we run from our destiny because we don't understand what's going on? We can't figure out in our mind why things happen the way they do. We have things planned out and we think it's going to go that way and this is what's going to happen and that's what's going to happen. And all of a sudden we find ourselves in the middle of a situation we don't understand with questions we seemingly don't have answers for. We've overlooked the evidence. We've overlooked the voice of God who tries to give us divine direction and we're lost. That's where these disciples were. They were lost. I'm not talking about lost in their sins. They were lost because they thought they lost the Messiah. Now they're declaring him a good prophet. Now they're calling him the man from Nazareth. When just 7 days earlier, they're declaring him as the Son of God, the Lord, and the King of Kings. I want to ask you, how many times have you lost hope? How many times have you had hope in something only for it to be lost? Maybe it was when you lost somebody you love. God, why? Why did you take them? Or why did you allow them to be taken? Maybe it was when you were diagnosed with a sickness and, Lord, I don't understand. Why as a child of God am I suffering with this? Or maybe it was when your kids have failed and made bad decisions. Or maybe it was just something that really causes you to question God. Oftentimes, life goes beyond our expectations. It goes beyond what we can figure out in our minds. But we have to understand that God is still on the throne. In the book of Galatians, it said, when the fullness of time had come, Let me tell you something. This is what I like about this story. Jesus Christ never went to plan B. The devil thought, if I can quiet him, if I could take him out of the picture, I can end this whole thing. So a lot of times people think that the devil had tried to do something, and then God's like, okay, no, you don't. I'm going to come up with a different plan. No, listen, God was never on plan B. He's always been on plan A. The Bible says that he was crucified before the foundations of the world were framed, that he died and paid a price before we were ever breathed into existence. Let me tell you something about Jesus. When Jesus says he will do something, he will do it. You can take it to the bank. You don't have to be afraid that it's not going to happen. However, oftentimes it don't happen the way we think it should. Why? Because we have a finite mind, and we have this way of which we think, and sometimes we get tunnel vision, and we think God can only do it this way, and he can only go this way, and this is the way it's going to happen, and all of a sudden our expectations don't come to pass the way we think we should. We are just like those disciples. When the going gets tough, we argue over things that don't matter. When the going gets tough, we get up and start showing aggression and start whacking off people's ears. When things don't go the way we should, we just start cursing and getting angry and mad. When things don't go the way we think we should, we just run. When have you lost hope? When have you? I want to read a question to you. I want to ask you something. When was it? When was it? Listen to this. When was it that you lost hope in the Lord? I'll be honest with you. I can't say I'm immune. Going through the experience we see in our world today, this is not what I had planned. I didn't have planned to come to you today through the internet and touching through technology. Thank God for technology. Thank God that we could still have service and we could still worship together. Thank God for that. But that's not what I had planned. I had a lot of plans. Things were going well, and all of a sudden, an unseen enemy comes on the picture, and our whole world gets just thrown into disarray. And I'm sure there's pastors all over America just as myself. God, what are you doing? Why is this happening? Listen, I don't have the answers. I'm not here to tell you the answer to why this is happening and why these things are going on. But what I am here to tell you is it didn't catch God by surprise. Before the foundation of the world were laid, God had a plan, and it's mapped out. He's always been in control. He always will be in control. He never goes to plan A. He never goes to plan B. He always stays on plan A. I don't know why this is happening, but I know who sits on the throne, and he's still there. And the Bible says he will never leave us, and he will never, ever forsake us. Now listen to this. Isaiah chapter 55 says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways." Listen, guys, it's a simple word. God thinks higher, deeper, longer, and wider than our minds can comprehend. This whole pandemic did not catch him by surprise. And I believe that God can work through this situation to carry out his plan. Listen, the disciples saw the death of Jesus Christ as defeat. But Paul says the cross was not defeat, it was the power of God in action. The death of Jesus was not defeat, it was victory over sin once and for all. Now, we have the luxury of going back and seeing what the disciples went through, and it's easy for us to say, why didn't they get it? Why couldn't they understand it? Why? We're Monday morning quarterbacks. We're looking back on history. We have things that they didn't have. We have every teaching of Jesus, or most of them, written down. We can read them. We can look at them. And we can surmise that Jesus had prepared them for 3.5 years for this, but yet the disciples walking in it. Sometimes you've ever heard the phrase, can't see the forest through the trees? The disciples still had a plan, but it didn't go that way. And I'm here to tell you, not every plan that we make goes the way we think they should. Resurrection Sunday was no regular Sunday. Easter morning today is not a regular Sunday. We didn't have planned to have these services via cast to your living rooms. We had plans of great celebration, our Sunday best on, Easter egg hunts, and our little kids dressed up nice. We had all these wonderful plans, and it seems like they all fell apart. And we're like, God, why? Why is this happening? You know, I always said as a pastor, for 30 years I've pastored churches, and for 30 years I would always say this, Easter Sunday morning is like the Super Bowl Sunday of the church world. Pastors start preparing for Easter 3 to 6 months in advance because it is one big, massive event. And all of those plans crumbled together and crumbled apart. And it's real easy for us to say, God, I just don't understand. But just like that resurrection morning, this resurrection morning, I can say, He died so I could live. He paid a price I could not afford. He went up so I don't have to go down. He did it for you and I. Things don't go the way we had planned, and sometimes it's hard for us to trust in the Lord. Sometimes it's easy for us to say, God, why? One of my favorite Old Testament writers is King David. If anybody went through tumultuous times in life, if anybody had lots of questions and why God this and why God that and why this happened and why that, it is King David. And he wrote something very powerful. I'd like to share it with you this morning. Matter of fact, I would like for you to take Psalms chapter 20, verses 6 through 9, and I would really love for you to read this scripture over and over this entire week. Listen to what it says. Now this I know. Now if you read the whole chapter, David is like, man, I don't understand this, and I don't understand that, and I can't figure that out. I don't have the answer here. But then he picks up on verse 6. He says, but this I know. Say that with me. This I know. The Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand. Now listen to this next phrase. Some may trust in horses and some may trust in chariots, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. They are brought to their knees and fail, but we rise and stand firm. Lord, give victory to the king and answer us when we cry. See, the nation of Israel, when the going get tough, they would often reach out to other countries for help. And one of the countries they would reach out to is the very country they were delivered from thousands of years prior. They reach out to Egypt. Why? Because Egypt had thousands of horses and thousands of chariots. Their army was one of the greatest in the world. So they would reach out and say, hey, our enemies are coming against us. Will you please help us? Will you please help us? And oftentimes the children of Israel were putting more faith in horses and chariots and the armies of Egypt than they were in the Lord. And David is facing some of the most difficult situations of his life. He has this question, he has that question. I don't understand this, I don't understand that. But one thing I know, one thing I know. What is it? Some are gonna trust in horses, some are gonna trust in chariots. But I choose to trust in the name of our Lord. Let me tell you something. We have one of the greatest governments that the world has ever seen. Our president is doing the best he can. Our vice president overseeing this pandemic doing the best he can. And he is a godly man. I've met him many times. He's a wonderful man of God. He is praying for us. He's praying for you. He's doing the best he can. Our governors are doing the best they can. Our government is doing the best they can. We have modern medicine. We've got all these technologies. We have all of these things. People are working on vaccines. People are working on this. They're working on that. And folks, let me tell you something. It would be easier for us as Christians to start putting our trust in that. Some trust in horses and chariots. Some trust in governments. Some trust in scientists. Some trust in our leaders. But yet, this morning, I want to declare that I'm going to trust in the name of the Lord my God. I might not understand what's going on. It might not be the pandemic that you're suffering with today. Maybe you've got a loved one who is sick. Maybe you have a family member who just died. Maybe you're going through a financial crisis and you've lost your job and you don't know how you're gonna pay your bills. And it's real easy for us to say, well, I'm gonna trust the government's gonna bail me out, and I'm gonna trust that this help's coming, and I'm gonna trust in that. Now, it's okay to tap into those things that are available to us, but I'm here to tell you that your trust must be in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who's still on the throne, who knew these things were going to happen, and yet he still has a plan that's interwoven. He never is going to go to plan B in your life. He's always going to be on plan A. I would like to end my message this morning asking you a few questions that I think are very imperative to ask. I want to ask you these questions because what I'm asking you is, do you trust him? Where in your life did you once have hope only to lose it because things didn't go the way you had planned? What is going on in your life right now or even in your past where your eyes need to be open to the fact that Jesus is still in the middle of your situation? Where do your eyes need to be open that the power of God is being demonstrated? You might not see it, but it's happening. Listen, the children of Israel, they're excited about Jesus coming into reign. But all of a sudden, this is one of the most craziest weeks in their life because what they thought would happen didn't happen, and who they thought was going to reign all of a sudden now being killed. And what they saw as a defeat was really the power of God in action. And I'm here to tell you that sometimes we don't understand why God does what he does. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And you might ask yourself this morning, yeah, but Pastor Josh, you don't understand what I'm going through. You don't understand where I'm at. You don't understand my situation. It might be easy for you to trust God, but you don't know what I'm going through. I'm here to tell you, I don't know. I've not been where you've been. I've not gone through what you've gone through. But I do know that Jesus Christ understands. The Bible said he was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. The Bible says that when we go through our weakest moment, he'll never leave us nor forsake us. That when we feel like he has failed us, he's actually there. One of my favorite poems that is mostly used during funerals is the poem about the footprints in the sand. And you know, you've heard this story. And it's about a guy who went to heaven and he looks on his life and it kind of looked like a beach to him. That'd be nice heaven, right? Beach, warm. And he saw two sets of footprints, and he recognized it was him and the Lord. But then he saw other times, and it was the roughest areas and the hardest patches of life. There was only one set. He said, Lord, I don't understand. Why in my difficult hour did you leave me? And Jesus said, I didn't leave you. It was during your difficult hour that I picked you up and carried you on my own back. And I'm here to tell you this morning, it doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter how hard it is. It doesn't matter how big it is and how difficult it might seem. Jesus Christ is still at work. He still loves you. He's still paying a price. And even if we can't see it, he's actively involved and working in your life. And you know what? Maybe you just need to throw your hands up this morning and say, Lord, forgive me and help me to trust you. Maybe you need to just climb up on the shoulders of Jesus and let him carry you through. Maybe you just need to put your trust in him again. Listen, it is okay to allow, you know, the government to help us in the ways that they can. There's nothing wrong with that, but never, ever, ever put your trust in those things. Keep your trust in the Lord. This resurrection morning, I want you to remember that. Let's pray together. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus, the one who paid the price, the one who before the foundations of the world were set into motion, said, Father, I'll pay the price. I'll be the penalty. I'll bear their sin. I'll take upon their shame so they don't have to. Father, we thank you for what Jesus did those many years ago when he was willing to die for me. Lord, your word says that when Jesus hung on the cross, he was thinking about me. He was thinking about us. Every person who's ever been saved or going to get saved, Jesus, their name went across his mind. The picture went through his eyes as he said, I'm paying the price for them. Father, it's real easy for us to lose hope. It's real easy for us to lose trust. It's real easy for us to start placing our trust in other things. But yet this morning, we declare some are going to trust in horses, some are going to trust in chariots, some are going to trust in government, some are going to trust in this, some are going to trust in that, some are going to try to trust even in their pastor. But yet we declare this morning, we are going to trust in the name of our God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. City Light, thank you for joining me this morning. I hope this message was a blessing. Make sure you put in your comments what prayer requests you might have, the things maybe that you're facing, or the things where you lost your hope, because I personally am going to pray over each and every one of them. God bless you, and thank you for joining me this morning.
Hey, I hope that message really touched your life. And if it did, I would love to hear from you this week. You can make a comment in the comment section below, or just reach out to me if you're friends with me on Facebook, or you can call the church number that's connected below. We would love to just pray for you and see how we can minister to you and kind of connect with you more about Jesus and more about what God is doing in your life. So let me say a closing prayer, and we can't wait to see you again next week. God, we thank you so much, God, that the work that you did for us on the cross, God, was to redeem us. God, that none of us are too far gone. Father, we thank you for this Easter season, that we continue to remember and experience what you did for us on the cross, and most importantly, what you did for us through the resurrection. We long to be near you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll bless you. We will see you next week.